Hello everyone, Daft2 with you. I want to try and cover on topics that fly-by-wire sims made improvements on, mainly on the A320 systems. Like not too long ago, they redid the electrical system on the system display lower ECAM screen, which is great. I think it would be even more great if we knew what on earth each generator is doing or where's the power source coming from. Well, that's why I'm here. I'm no engineer or tech savvy, but in the real world, When you get a type rating in the A320, you feel like you're an engineer at the same time as a pilot. Maybe it's because you wanted to understand the reason why the aircraft's behaving that way. So let's give it a go. The electrical power system has a 115 to 200 volt and 400 hertz alternating current and a 28 volt direct current. So there's two types of electrical currents that are used. You have AC, which is alternating current, and DC, which is direct current. The electrical system produces AC power and some of it is converted to DC from the batteries. The aircraft has three main AC generators that can supply the whole system in the event the normal AC generation stops providing electrical source. So there's a backup generator that supplies AC power. Now here's when you're having a rough day now. If all AC generation is lost, then batteries become a last resort and supplies converted DC power to AC power for consumption. Here's a schematic of the electrical system. I know it's hard to decipher at first sight, but this is where we'll break down what each component of the system does. Start with the main sources that generate electrical power. The AC generators. Two engine driven generators go through an integrated drive, which supplies electrical power. You see the IDG is integrated driven generators. As if you notice here, there's a temperature right next to it, it's very hot. And the only way for it to get cool has to do with the fuel systems. The IDG goes through fuel, which allows the fuel to cool the IDG, and vice versa, so it's like a cycle, basically. The IDG is very hot, so the only way to cool down the IDG has to do with the fuel system, because the fuel is very cool, well, cold, but cool, which allows it to cool it down a little bit. So that's pretty much basically how it basically cools down. So each generator supplies up to 90 kVA at 115 to 200 volts and 400 hertz. One APU generator with the same concept as the previous two generators. The APU generator can take over and supply power to either AC buses or both. Each generator has its own GCU or generator control unit that controls the generator. The GCU mainly monitors the frequency and voltage of the generator, making sure it's within safe parameters, and has a protection line called GLC, which is called Generator Line Contractor. Now the GLCs, to break it down the easy way, if a line is parallel, it's closed, means there's power passing through it. If the GLC is open, nothing's bypassing anything, so there's no connection, so it will be arced up or basically open, which means nothing's going through, or the contactors are open. So once again, GLC is closed means something's going through it, it's passing one another. A contact that's open means nothing's going in between. So moving forward, we have the external power from near the nose of the aircraft. The ground power connector allows ground power to supply the bus bars. A ground power control unit, GPCU, same thing as previously, protects and controls the contractor lines. It has the same applications as an open and close function, which allows the power to go through in and out and prevents it also. Next, you have the emergency generator, which requires blue hydraulic. So electrical system, mainly the emergency generator, involves the hydraulics panel as well, because the generator uses a hydraulic motor in order to function. But I'll dive deep into that and tell you right now that, once again, needs blue hydraulic to drive the generator to work automatically and supply emergency AC power to the electrical system in the event of all three main generators fail. So what I mean is that if all three generators are inoperative or have failed, the emergency generator will function in it as long as the blue hydraulic is available for the drive. So what I'm trying to say is the power supply is 5 kVA, that's less than a normal amount, with the same 115-200 volt and 400 hertz power. It also has a GCU, so that does the same application as the previous generators, in addition to controlling the emergency generator startup. So once again, for the emergency generator to work properly function, it requires blue hydraulics. It requires a blue system hydraulics, because once again the motor runs on hydraulics. Lastly, we have the stack inverter, which converts DC power from battery number 1 into the AC power, which is transferred to the AC central bus. It might not be modeled into this aircraft, but when you're above 50 knots, the stack inverter automatically turns on. The stack inverter automatically turns on when the aircraft is supplied using batteries only, regardless of the position of the batteries. What I mean by that is that, regardless of whether you put the battery panel on or off position, the stack inverter is already working, regardless, as long as you're above 50 knots. But how about if you're below 50 knots? Well, the inverter is turned on anyways, as long as the batteries are set, both batteries are set to the on position. Now, if the batteries are off, the inverter is not going to work, so you want to make sure the battery is on the on position throughout the flight if you're below 50 knots. Next, we're going to go to DC generations. So here you have two component or thing, I don't know, it's called a transform rectifier. Then there's a possible, there's a third one that's according to the airline, I guess, as an option. For the DC power to power up the entertainment usage. Like, for example, you know, that screens on the seat in front of you? That's part of it. That's where the electrical consumptions come from. It's from TR number 3. Anyways, it produces 200 amps of DC current. And there's a fourth one. Remember, this will be a third one, but if you have another TR, this will be a fourth one. So another TR called Essential TR, which powers DC Essential bus from the generator, from the emergency generator. Two batteries have a capacity of 23 amps and are connected to hub buses. Each battery has its own BCL, or battery charge limiter. The BCL monitors and controls the battery, making sure it's within parameters. If the batteries are beyond 25.5 and 28 maximum, it would open the contactors, preventing any consumption from the battery. And then it will display a fault light at the same time. Circuit breakers, you got two types of them, you have green and black. Green circuit breakers have monitoring capabilities, which means that if it trips for more than a minute, the message CB trip warning is displayed on the ECAM message. Black circuit breakers are not monitored and requires visual check, because there will be no warning given. Now you have these red circular caps that's on the circuit breakers. Those are the wingtip brakes, CBs. That's to prevent anyone from applying any manual resets. Now we'll talk about the electrical operations. Very simple and straightforward. The electrical power source have a priority list from generators to batteries, and it goes like this: generators, external power, APU, RAT, and batteries. I'll explain about the RAT in a bit. So APU, or external power, can supply the whole electrical system. One generator can supply the whole electrical system. That's the power of all the logic in the Airbus. One generator can supply its respective AC bus, and the APU can supply the other AC bus simultaneously. Both generators can be connected and worked in parallel. So what I mean by that is that generator 1 can't supply AC bus 1 at the same time. Generator 2 supplies AC bus 1 at the same time. It has to work either its own respective buses, and that's it. Unless there's a failure, then one of the generators takes over the other. So once again, I said each generator powers its respective AC bus. As you can see, the generator number 1 powers AC bus 1, and generator number 2 powers AC bus number 2 through its GLC generator line contractor. AC bus 1 supplies the AC essential bus through its contactor. AC bus 1 transfers through TR1, converts AC power to DC power, and allows TR1 to supply DC power to DC bus number 1, and then to the DC bus, which is the biggest bus battery, our biggest battery bus among both batteries, and then to its DC essential bus as well. The same can be said about AC bus number 2 and TR number 2, but only supplies DC power to DC bus number 2 only. The batteries are connected to the largest DC bat bus, like I just said earlier, if charging is needed. When fully charged, the BCL disconnects or opens its contactor. Now let's talk about normal scenarios. If one generator fails, the opposite generator takes over and supplies power to the entire electrical system, which automatically sheds a portion of the galley's load. Or if APU is available, the APU takes over the failed generator. AC bus 1 not being supplied, AC bus 2 can supply AC essential bus, and essential TR can supply the DC essential bus through the AC essential feed pushed button overhead. Because earlier we said that generator 1 supplies AC bus 1, but what if AC bus 1 doesn't supply AC essential in its respective shed? So instead there's an alternate way, so you just click on AC essential feed, and it'll utilize AC bus number 2 instead. So DC bus number 2 supplies DC bus number 1, and DC bus automatically after 5 seconds. If one TR fails, the TR contactor opens automatically. In the event there's an overheat or minimum current produced, the opposite TR automatically takes over the failed TR. The essential TR supplies the DC essential bus. If both TRs failed, both DC bus 1, 2 and the BAT bus are not supplied, but the DC essential bus is supplied by the essential TR. If AC bus 1, 2 are lost and the aircraft is above 100 knots, now here's the part I was talking about, the RAT. The RAT, or ram air turbine, extends automatically. This is the RAT that I was referring to earlier. The RAT powers the blue hydraulic that the emergency generator requires to function. Think of it as this: no blue hydraulic means no emergency generator, because this generator uses a hydraulic motor to function. The emergency generator supplies the AC essential bus and DC essential bus via the essential TR, which is known as the RAT's nest. Once again, the emergency generator supplies four things: the AC essential bus and its respective shed, and DC central bus and its respective shed. Now, if the RAT doesn't deploy automatically or the SB is below 100 knots, the emergency generator has nothing to function. The emergency generator has nothing for it to function its motor. Instead, the batteries and stack inverter automatically are utilized, causing the system to shed the AC central shed and DC central shed. If on the ground below 100 knots, on the DC BAT bus automatically connects to the batteries. If below 50 knots, the AC central bus is automatically shed, leading to all the CRTs or cathode ray tubes screens to go out lights out, which means that all screens will go black. Also, a good point to know is that when the RAT and emergency generator comes to life, which takes around 8 seconds for it to deploy, the batteries supply the electrical network during those 8 seconds. That's all for electrical system in regards to the ECAM mainly. Next video we'll be talking about the controls indicators for the electrical panel. So yeah, I hope you guys found this very informative. Thanks for watching. I'll be seeing you guys in the next video. Take care.